The hour draws near. The giants await to do battle. For their brothers, for their fathers, for their mentors, for the crowds hungry for victory. The preparation is done, the adrenaline pumps, the nerves twitch, and the echoes of success and failure count for nothing.
Today is a new day. All men are equal. Past digressions erased, and the high of victory, a distant memory.
Today we start afresh, a new beginning. Seen like never before, where anything is possible.
Today the battle begins.
Welcome to the Aviva Premiership. And this supersized tanker will be the silver lining to whichever of the 12 Aviva Premiership teams emerges after 9 months of blood, sweat, tears and the rest as champions of England. And we start where it will all end, here at Twickenham, and hoping to disprove the theory, the notion that all front row forwards are brainless meatheads once and for all. That's an outrageous theory, that, by the way.
I can't disprove that.
It's David Flatman, ex-Saracens, Bath and England. We always get excited about the unwrapping of a new season. Why should we be salivating just a little bit more ahead of this one?
We're coming off the back of a monumental summer. England dominant in Argentina, Lions dominant in Australia with George North, King of the Lions, landing in the Premiership. You've got a new scrum to look forward to, which you'll agree is hugely interesting. We both can't wait. And the two Deans are back in the Premiership, Ryan and Richards. Can't wait.
New laws, new faces, old faces in new places. Plenty to look forward to. More pearls of wisdom from you, I hope. Or was that your only one?
That's it.
Ah, yeah. There we go. Don't worry about that. Week one, let's see how it's shaped up. Newcastle and Bath got matters underway on Friday night. On Saturday, away from Twickenham, all eyes were on George North as he made his Northampton debut at Franklin's Gardens, where Exeter were the visitors. Gloucester and Sale met at King's Home, and the champions Leicester started the defence of their title at home to Worcester on Sunday. So the first whistle of the new season was blown at Kingston Park on Friday night. Dean Richards back in the big time with Newcastle as they took on Bath. And Jill Douglas followed the path of a veritable monsoon to the northeast to see how it all panned out.
A bit of rain is certainly not going to dampen the enthusiasm of the Falcons faithful as they celebrate their team's return to English rugby's top flight. Tonight's match against Bath also marks the return of Dean Richards to the Premiership after an absence of 4 years, 3 years serving a ban and a year up here in the North East steering the Falcons to promotion from the Championship.
Do you think the Premiership has changed in your absence?
Not really, no. I mean, there's a few changes here or there. There's obviously all the rule changes and whatever, and obviously change of sponsorship and whatever. But in essence, the rugby's not changed too much. The personnel hasn't changed that too much either, so no.
It's still a very, very competitive league. How do you think you'll transfer from the Championship up into the Premiership?
Yeah, I think it'll be hard for us. We had sort of minimal time to prepare for it, finishing on the 29th of May, but the boys have acquitted themselves well during the pre-season, and so hopefully, you know, we'll be fine. But you can never tell, and tonight will be a way of just finding out exactly where we stand.
Dean Richards has made a dozen new signings over the summer, and six of them should make their debut tonight against Bath, including a new Scottish halfback partnership featuring Mike Blair from Brieve and a return to the North East for Phil Godman. A few new signings for Bath over the summer. What can we expect from this squad this season?
Look, Jill, we want to just play a little bit different than last year. And the foundations that we laid last year and our fundamentals, the driving game, the scrum and our defence, we believe still there. We want to try and add some extra bits, and obviously that's on attack where we want to try and score more points. And to do that, you've got to take risks, and that's what we hope to do throughout the season. Now, after saying that, I don't think you'll see many tonight because it's not the conditions to do that. So we've got recruited a really young, exciting back line, and we'll be stupid not to use them when the conditions let us.
The ground staff have repainted the lines three times at Kingston Park today because of the weather. The big question is, which team will cope best with these challenging conditions? Playing into a strong headwind, it was Bath's George Ford who scored the very first points of this new Aviva Premiership season. A lengthy delay broke the game up in the early stages with Jamie Heller stretchered off with a head knock, so a debut for former Saracens centre Adam Powell. Both teams struggled to keep hold of the ball in the wet conditions. Falcons had an opportunity to level the score just over the half-hour mark. Phil Godman's effort drifted wide. George Ford, who featured in Leicester's championship-winning side last season, demonstrated his goal-kicking quality to give his new club a 6-0 lead at half-time. In driving rain, it was always likely to be a forwards-dominated match. Bath continued to dominate, and that forward pressure eventually paid off.
This is the closest they've been to the try line. They're spinning and turning and scoring, and the match is ended as a contest by the big Samoan Anthony Peronese. Bath looking for a second try to put in the hand luggage on the way home, and they've got it.
For a side who struggled to win away from home last season, it was, in the end, a thoroughly professional performance from Bath. What do you think the difference was tonight then, just an ability to play the conditions in front of you?
Yeah, I think we had a good chat before in the hotel about, you know, how you can play the conditions, and playing into the wind and with the wind is two completely different things, and I thought George controlled the game really, really well from 10, and the other thing is when we got the points on offer, we took them, so all credit to him.
What do you learn from an evening like this?
The boys will just take from this that, you know, with the wind and the rain first half, then you've got to capitalise on it and take the points when you can, and we didn't quite do that as well as we should have done.
So absolutely filthy conditions up in the North East on Friday night. We've just actually, quickly before we go into that, snuck into the temporary changing rooms here at Twickenham because the real changing rooms are being revamped. They've got a big tent and this is where they're hanging out today. They've got all the waters, all the bars. What I don't understand, David Flatman, is why the scales?
Way in, way out. See how much weight you sweat off during the game. Every kilo you lose is a litre of water you've got to get on straight after the game.
OK, let's walk and let's lose some kilos. Last night, obviously very difficult conditions. Yeah. Newcastle supporters, Dean Richards, is it a season-long scrap for survival or can they dare to hope for more?
I think they can dare to hope for more. Last night's conditions were vile, really, really bad. And effectively, it wasn't about game plans. It wasn't about organisation. It was about brute force. Bath had more weight and power and dominated. I think Newcastle will be very organised, relatively conservative this year, but I think they'll be bottom third, but I just think they might do it.
OK, Bath, season after season, we've talked about the potential, the promise of that side. Is this season going to be the season they finally deliver on all the potential?
I think this season will show a vast improvement from Bath. I think they've got a huge amount of potential in that back line, so exciting, some of those young players, but they are young players. I think there'll definitely be an improvement this year. I think next year will be better, and I think the year after that, really could see this team really coming through.
OK, so that's what's happened in the North East. Next up, we're going to focus on events here in the Deep South. All the action from the London doubleheader coming right up. It's always quite a party here at Twickenham on the first weekend of the Aviva Premiership season as the London clubs have their little get-together here at the home of English rugby. And leading the way this time round, London Irish, who many astute observers think may have a pretty tough season ahead, had to contend with a small matter of Saracens first up. And talking us through all the key moments in the commentary box were Austin Healy, Lawrence Dallaglio and Alistair Eakin.
After only 9 games last season and a recovery from back surgery, Ireland's Tomás O'Leary is back at scrum half and all eyes will be on the speedster, Marlon Yard, as he looks to build on his superb performances on the tour of Argentina with England this summer. Saris Well, their director of rugby, Mark McCall, has assembled 12 internationals in his starting 15. Jamie George assumes senior hooking duties with John Smith retired and Skulk Britt suspended. Jacques Berger makes a welcome return at open side after a lengthy knee injury. Important line-out ball again, secured by Joubert. They're closing in on the London Irish try line here. Stevens to Vunipola, just a metre out. Driving over the line, first try of the game. Saracens breaking through after less than 10 minutes and Jamie George is the man on the score sheet.
What a try from George, Jamie George. We talked about it. That's three times now that Saracens have cleverly, from line-out, caught the ball, shifted the focus of the attack, sucked the London Irish defenders into thinking they're going to drive the ball. Look at this, very, very clever here. Just works it very, very nicely, shifts the focus of attack. And look at that huge, huge hole there.
David Pace. Oh, that's a beautiful offload to Kieran Lowe. Has he got the pace and the speed to go all the way? Yes, he has. Well played, Kieran Lowe. Making the most of the opportunity. Had a bit to do as well here, Lawrence.
Yeah, fantastic though. But yeah, the key was being able to draw in the two defenders. Fantastic offload and showed real pace to get himself over the line.
Fisher, smashed by Hargreaves.
Felt that one up here on the gantry. That was an enormous hit. Forced the tackle. What a way to respond.
And Saracens reassert their authority. Vunipola. Early penalty as the Exiles are pinged for failing to roll away. It's through. And so Saracens extend their lead, 24 points to 10. Lots of men out here. Vunipola goes straight. Options each way. They are bearing down on that try line now. Wigglesworth goes left. Little bit of indecision. Brad Barrett. Just 1 metre out. Wigglesworth. And over the line is Mako Vunipola.
Just got that power game now, Saracens, haven't they?
Sheridan. As Halofia juggles with it. Gets it away to Marlon Yard, and Yard is through! Irish aren't done yet. We're going to see a lot more of this man over this season.
Humphreys sees the outside pass. Sheridan this time does well. Marlon Yard's down, the cramp's gone. I've got a chance of scoring, he's on his feet. Where's my cramp gone? It's completely, my legs are fresh as a daisy, and then he goes at the corner. Great skill, I think he's going to feel it a bit now, though.
On that 22-metre line, nice quick hands. Spurling, part of the victorious England under 20 side, played in that Junior World Championship final. Another penalty. Will they have the time to take it? Yes, they will. Real urgency now about Saracens as they seek that final try bonus point, and maybe Ashton can deliver them one. Yes.
Now he's touched the line with the first bit. It's a good try. It's an excellent finish. It's a finisher's try. Well played, Chris Ashton.
Greg?
Yes, Graham.
Yep, you may award the try.
There we go. Chris Ashton secures the bonus point for Saracens. J. just fractionally wide from Farrell, and that draws proceedings to a close. Saracens up and running in the Premiership, 42 points to 20.
Jamie, well done, man of the match, two tries. Are you disappointed you didn't manage to pull off the hat-trick?
mate, to be honest, I'm just happy with two. I can't really complain. So Skulk Brits and I have got a little competition who scores the most tries this season. So, you know, I'm two up, so I'm happy with that.
What a cracking start on that front. But how far off top gear do you feel you were today?
I think obviously we had a few work-ons at the beginning of the season. This is our first game. We had, you know, some good pre-season games. But we laid down a good platform, and I think, you know, it's a great platform for us to move forward on. And, you know, we're really happy with that.
It's always a quick turnaround at the London doubleheader. Already the two teams for part two are warming up out there. But let's reflect on part one, London Irish against Saracens, a convincing victory for Saracens. What did you garner from those two performances about their future prospects?
I think ultimately Saracens taught us nothing new, but they reaffirmed what a powerful unit they are. In defence, incredibly organised. Kick chase, which is a great gauge of a team's work ethic, impeccable. There always seem to be numbers for Saracens. When they come around the corner looking to take that ball off 9 or off 10, they're well organised. There are always two or three options, as we saw with Jamie George's first try, straight across the front of Reece Gill. London Irish, really interesting one, because they are a team back to struggle. They lost a lot of talent over the summer. But today, I think they showed enough. I think they showed signs of real attacking threat. Topsy Ojo, really, really threatening, really sharp. Marlon Yard, what a talent. But he's not just a talent, he's a safe, aggressive player. Really, really good asset for the team.
Watched both very closely through the course of the season, of course. Now, South Saracens can normally claim to have the most eye-catching signings in the off-season. But I think they've been eclipsed by Northampton this year with their signings, in particular their prize asset, George North, who was unveiled at Franklin's Gardens on Saturday afternoon ahead of their game against Exeter. George North, they don't come cheap, but was that money well spent in your view?
If he stays fit, that's money very, very well spent, no matter what they've spent. He's a sensational rugby player. So's Alex Corbacero, who they signed on the loose end. Star of the Lions. In fact, a Lions legend, you know, from nowhere, from being on the England tour, which is not nowhere. Brought in, was an absolute star. But for me, the number one signing for them, Khan Fotualiti at scrum halves. What a player. If they can keep those three guys fit, they're going to be table toppers.
Some would say, and Northampton supporters themselves might say, why did we not spend money on another fly half, perhaps?
I think Stephen Myler actually last season really sort of made that spot his own, and really, for me, did enough to say he is a top four starting fly half. I think he's a really, really high quality player. He needs the right guys around him. Who doesn't? Johnny Wilkinson did too. I think he's a really good player, and I think they brought in three top guys.
Well, the first challenge for North and Northampton was to repel the threat from the west. Do you see what I did there?
Really
in the
good.
Shape of
really
Exeter
good.
Chiefs. And talking through this one was Martin Guineam.
It's a Saints team sprinkled with an abundance of stardust. Lions heroes Alex Corbacero and George North make their debuts, as does the former Rotherham captain Sam Dickinson. Exeter head coach Rob Baxter has brought in seven new faces this summer, though just one of them is on from the start here, the Wales wing Tom James. The Wallaby Dean Mum is the captain. Dixon, an early opportunity here for Northampton. Dickinson through one tackle, taken down the second time. Corbacero, well, he was not backwards there. That will lift Exeter hearts. Myler out to Burrell. Oh, what vision. Hartley, the captain in space, Dylan Hartley. And I think he's got the first try of the new season. JP Doyle is going to confirm. And there it is, Dylan Hartley. Well, he was the villain at Twickenham, but there is no player who is loved more than anyone here at the Gardens than Dylan Hartley.
Use it.
Referee urging Northampton to use it. PC, George PC, that was having to be very quick. Burrell, here's George North. His first meaningful touch. What speed. Well, if that is an indication of what is to come over the course of the next few months, every penny of those Northampton season tickets will be money well spent. I'm sure many will agree with that. Jack Yendall starting today at hooker for Exeter. Neil Clark having moved on to play for Oyena in the top 14. Here's Sam Dickinson. The start at Northampton was halted by an arm injury. Good to see him getting his first start here. It's been an impressive start from the Saints, particularly by Luther Burrell. He releases Ken Peasey. PC, what a step. PC gets the second try. And these are very worrying signs for the Chiefs. Tackles missed there. That was the first one. Burrell releasing Ken PC. A second miss, a third miss. Aidan Thomas.
Now forward six.
Back to Steenson. Steenson, one of the players who came up with Exeter from the Championship. Back to Ben Foden. Stuart Lancaster and Graham Rowntree watching on. Ben Foden will be anxious to impress them. Oh, he's still going, is Ben Foden. Foden out to Wood. Wood looks over his shoulder. There's no one there. And Northampton have their third try. Well, it was a cruel bounce for Tom James. Foden was coming through at pace. And a nifty little step from Tom Wood does the rest. It's been a shining start to Ken Peace's season. There's Dowson. He's already picked up his first yellow. Wood, good hands out to Foden. Look at the continuity from the Saints. Another chance for George North to run. Good tackle that from Phil Dolman. Saints just outside the 22. There goes Corbisiero. Hartley. Here's Dickinson. Courtney Laws. George Peasy. All too easy. The try bonus point wrapped up, and we've been playing a little more than half an hour. Well, JP Doyle is going to pass this one on to the TMO Rowan kick. He wants to check something. It's the first time this season that we've got TMOs at all six games. And he's looking at this pass here from PC to Dowson.
JP, I have a report for you.
Go ahead, please.
The pass was not forward.
Okay.
Find! Set! Yes, nine.
Dave Lewis getting yes, nine, the final instruction from the referee. The pick-up from Johnson. The Chiefs have it. Lewis, that was out to White, and there goes Mum, and he's grounded it. So has the man leading his side for the first time in the Premiership got the Chiefs' first try of the season.
Any reason I cannot award the try?
JP Kitty, yep. I've got a report for you.
Go ahead.
You may award the try.
It's been a fairly subdued second-half performance from the Saints. Khan Kotoalii steering things there at the base, the replacement scrum half. JP Doyle's got his arm out, but the Saints have got the drive on. And with the ball under his arm, there is Samu Manoa driving it over the line. And the try has been awarded. And from beneath the pile of bodies will emerge the man from Concord, California, Samu Manoa. Northampton have a habit of winning on the opening day. They've done it for the last six seasons. But this the first time in almost a decade that they've picked up all 5 points. Perhaps not a complete 80-minute performance from the Saints, but then that's only because their opening half hour was so powerful, so dominant, that the outcome was never in doubt.
We had a very good first half, getting our bonus four tries in that first half. Second half, I think we've got to look at our discipline. I think to go down to 14 men, two yellow cards, you're playing for 20 minutes with 14 men. We need to work on that. We were hardly out of our own half until towards the end of that second period. So plenty to work on, but lots of positives as well.
So a pretty emphatic statement of intent by Northampton and Franklin's Garden, seeing off Exeter Chiefs in some style too. Now coming up in a moment after the break, we've got part two of the London doubleheader as London Wasps took on the 2012 champions Harlequins. A year ago, London Wasps and Harlequins produced one of the most thrilling and dramatic games in the history of the Premiership. I guess it's probably a bit too much to ask for a repeat performance, but they are two teams who like to play attractive rugby, so just maybe lightning will strike twice. Talking through all the key moments of this one in the commentary box are Matt Dawson, Ben Kay and Nick Mullins.
There are five new faces, some familiar than others. You won't need to be introduced to Andy Goode, the winner of five premierships during his Leicester days. Outside him, Ben Jacobs is back at the club. New names elsewhere at tight head, Jake Cooper Woolley, and Guy Thompson and Ed Jackson in the back row. Saki back in the premiership. Just look who he's playing against. The forwards have a largely familiar look to them, but mention of a couple of youngsters. George Merrick, who's just 20, plays for the first time in the second row, and Will Collier gets first dibs at filling in for the departed James Johnston. Andy Goode, who's been there and done most things for his new club, kicks off. And Wasps have done the first thing right. They have regathered possession from that kickoff. And there was Sam Jones, the captain, looking for some holes early on. Great to see Ben Jacobs back. Familiar face at the club again. Sought his fortunes for a couple of years in Japan and Australia, but he's back involved, locking up that defence as he did so well. Another new man, Jake Cooper Woolley, on his debut, the tight head prop.
Saki doing really well to step in early. It was a bit of an overlap for the Wasps around this corner.
This is Guy Thompson. So many new names, new faces for us and Wasps followers to get used to. Arrives from Jersey in the Championship, and this is an outstanding start. Oh, what about that? Sam Jones up to Joe Launchbury. Season launched.
Harquin's a little bit slow to reorganise in defence. What a fantastic line that is. And the offload to Launchbury, biding his time, accelerating onto the ball.
Here goes Rob Shaw. He's driven back by Wade. He was having a little bit of help. Here goes Danny Kerr. Evades the clutches of Tom Palmer. Turner Hall, Evans. Ball's lost forward. And Wasps have a real opportunity here with Charlie Hayter. Simpson to Varndell. Pins the ears back. Away. What a tackle.
Lowe perhaps was at full speed quicker, but what a tap tackle against one of the quickest men in the league. The whole point of why we needed to change the laws was because teams had just worked out that if they all worked together and pushed together, the synergy meant that they were a lot stronger. So that's why hookers stopped hooking for the ball. So the flanker will call the shove. So he's saying that three on the far side, Cooper Woolley retreats, while Mullen goes forward, and they're just trying to swing it round.
Well, if you can scoop a ball over from 43 metres, Nick Evans just scooped one over.
Wedge, that wasn't it?
That was
fantastic.
Just outrageous. Dixon, Easter. Sense that there's space, one or two opportunities out wide now to the left, and Dixon feels that as well, and so too does Lowe. Brown was held up. Dixon! It's been coming. Oh, it's been coming, and Dixon finally, in the last 10 minutes of the match, has Quinns ahead for the first time.
And Mike Brown's line comes from deep, times his run to perfection, and that sucks in all those Wasps defenders. So when they come around the corner with quick ball and all the momentum, all the defenders are thinking, I must get round and wide.
This is Mazzy siding through. Jacobs, oh, if he could have got the ball away. That had to be a try. It might yet. Wade, Varndell. The two big try scorers last season conspiring one more time. Goode. What a story he would write if he scored what might be the winning try on his debut. 10 seconds to go.
Wasps need a little bit of width here. They don't want to be running into that white brick wall in front of them. They want to get just outside.
Thanks, mate. This is for the match on the opening day of the new Aviva Premiership season. Johnson, the ball's there. Goode! Palmer!
Yes, John.
Wasps! However, it's in the corner. It's right by the flag.
Brilliant play from Ashley Johnson. Hickson goes round the corner. Look at the offload. That creates it. Good alert to it. He knows where Palmer is. Flings it out wide. Palmer knows the pace is coming across. He can step inside, wrong foot them, just does enough to avoid Sacchi's clasp. Good finish.
This is what Wasps have paid the money for. This is what so many other clubs wanted. Decides it. The upright decides it's Harlequin's day on the opening day. But what a finish. Not quite what we had 12 months ago, but not bad.
Sam, what is it with you and Harlequins on the opening day of the season?
I don't know, we come up with some thrillers, don't we? We're bitterly disappointed with that. We played really well in the first half to go in at half-time like we did last year up. And then it was that first 20 minutes after half-time, we really let them get back into it with ill discipline. They got some penalties, came back on terms, and then we let the try in. And then it came down to the last minute, and obviously massive pressure on Goody, and fortunately we fell up short.
Our work rate in the first half was poor, especially defensively. Couldn't deal with the kick-off, and our reactions weren't good enough. But to be fair to Watts, you know, that's 3 years in a row. I mean, they blasted us last year. They did Saracens the year before, the defending champions. They seem to come here, and we knew about that, but there's nothing much we can do about them. We're concentrating ourselves, and we're disappointed with aspects of that, but my God, you know, George Lowe's try-saving tackle over there, what we just did at the end to try and deny them, unfortunately it didn't work out, but, you know, we had to defend for 5 minutes. You know, that shows the character of this squad and the belief we have.
Do you think on Monday morning, when you get a chance to reflect, you might actually take quite a lot from this game, bearing in mind where you were two seasons ago, steadying the ship last season, but you're competing with guys who were champions 2 years ago?
Definitely, we've worked really hard this pre-season. We've brought a lot of new guys in, and we're developing really well as a squad. We're on a journey. It starts here as a new squad. We brought in 14 new players, but we really believe we could have gone out there and won that. So it's bitterly disappointing.
Well, I think that must be the smartest groundsman you're ever likely to see. His name is Ian, we found out, and he likes to lawnmower in his suit. Like, I like a man who does that.
Don't you?
Got standard. Always. Actually, black tie for me. But another thriller. We didn't think it could happen twice. Another, you know, one-point thriller. Width of the post between success and failure. From Wasps' point of view, they'll be hurting tonight, but how many positives do you think they should take out of their performance?
I think they'll hurt regardless. They'll feel awful in there, but they were hugely competitive against one of the country's top teams, and their defence was very nearly immaculate. You know, they didn't quite deal with Hugo Monya's power, but also around the field they were full of numbers, full of enthusiasm, full of intent. Just around the breakdown, both Carl Dixon when he came on and Danny Kerr for the first hour or so really caused a few problems. Aside from that, the defence looked really, really sharp, really tight. At the breakdown, they were very, very competitive, and you know, I had Quinns down to win this a bit more comfortably. Wasps looked powerful. They looked together.
Quinns didn't really get involved in the transfer dealing market over the off-season. They have got a settled squad. But do you sense that the question mark is bigger over their title credentials this season than it has been for the previous two?
Do you know what I think? I think externally, yes. And I think, having seen today, they didn't quite have the zip we've come to expect from Quinns, but it's round one, so I think we can forgive them that. Everyone's lungs were burning. It's a big old pitch at Twickers, immaculately mown by Ian. But I think internally, I still get the sense from watching them, from the body language, there are no question marks internally. They still look to have that belief that, you know, they were disappointed with this victory. They were disappointed in the manner in which they won and nearly lost. I think they still have the belief which got them to the top, and that's dangerous.
OK, well, while Ian, in his suit, does the lawnmowing, let's focus on Sale, who didn't get a Premiership win last time out until November. They weren't dealt the easiest of hands in week one with a trip to Kingshome.
So now it's confirmed, week one is the time to visit Gloucester. After seven straight defeats to start last term, Sale got off to a flyer against a team for whom the first 40 minutes of the campaign seemed to come as a nasty shock. They were certainly surprised by Mark Quato's 79th Premiership try. The TV match official dismissed Gloucester's calls for a forward pass by Nick McLeod, but they couldn't blame bad luck for an 11-point deficit at the break, which grew larger 11 minutes into the second half. Quato with the chip through for Andy Forsyth. And this time the home fans cried offside against the centre. The appeals waved away again by the TMO, and Gloucester were looking at an opening day defeat for the fourth season running. That prospect stirred them to action, not all of it laudable. Quato tipped in the tackle by Billy Twelvetrees, with referee Andrew Small deciding on yellow rather than red. With their England centre in the bin, all seemed lost. But while he was missing, Gloucester finally snapped out of it. Henry Trinder finding a way through. And there was just a chance, but only if their kicker could find his range. Freddie Burns had endured a first half to forget from the tee, but a conversion and two quick penalties cut the arrears to 3 points, with time and momentum on Gloucester's side. But Sale's desire to secure a first away win since February proved stronger. Their last foray forward gave replacement Joe Ford the chance to stretch the lead once more. The last 10 minutes passed all too slowly for the Sharks, especially once replacement Ross Harrison was sin-binned. The 14 men denied Gloucester's last chance. And then Steve Diamond and his men could finally relax. 12 months ago, they lost their opener by almost 40 points. This felt rather better, especially for a 33-year-old winger who'd given the Premiership's young pretenders something to think about.
Always nice, yeah. I had a little bit of banter with Christian Way this morning on Twitter about when Tom Van Dell was going to take over. So I was hoping that them two weren't going to score today. I don't know if they have or not. But no, it's always nice, little things like that are good.
Didn't have too much to celebrate last year, certainly first 12, 13 games. It's just good to come to Kings Home, a fantastic place to play and get a win. Not many teams do it often, and you know, we'll certainly have a celebration tonight over that.
Well, Nigel, that wasn't the start you were hoping for. What was your take on that one today?
They were the better team today, in fairness to Sale. You know, they came here, they put us into territory and chased hard, and we couldn't get out of that territory in the first half. And also set piece let us down. Didn't give us a platform really to play off. And theirs did. And fair enough, they were better than us in the contact area as well.
Well, I'm not sure too many people saw that one coming. Sale winning at King's Home in round one. Is that a case of underestimating Sale or overestimating Gloucester?
It has to be us underestimating Sale, I think. But King's Home is a very, very interesting place to go and play. Externally, you think it's intimidating, but actually you get there, there's such sporting hostility coming from the Shed in particular that it's wonderful, and sometimes it inspires the best performance of a season from a team.
And Gloucester finished the season 5 points adrift of the playoff places last time out. Are they more or less likely to make up that shortfall this time round?
I think they're more likely to make it up. They have lost a bit of knuckle in their big Jim Hamilton going over to Montpellier. That's a big loss. Very good line-out forward, but a hard edge around the field. They've brought in James Hudson. Now, he might not have those hard edges. He's got some of his own, but he's not quite the monster of Big Jim is. Not many are, but he will guarantee a lot of good, clean ball from the set piece. And with a back line like Gloucester's, that makes them ever more threatening.
They're no strangers to sluggish starts either. I think they had one a couple of seasons ago. But so maybe it's a thing they do, and then
maybe
they gather momentum. Anyway, we've got one more game to show you, and it's definitely worth sticking around for, as Leicester begin the defence of their title at home to Dean Ryan's Warriors, the final piece of the round one jigsaw coming up right after this break. Well, after a fire on the team bus on their last away trip, Worcester were hoping for an easier ride to Welford Road. They weren't expecting one, though, when they got there. Dean Ryan's returned to the big time, featuring a challenge of the defending champions on their own patch, albeit with the director of rugby, Richard Cockrell, sitting in the stands. Not exactly easing back into it. And talking through all the action at Welford Road were Austin Healy, Ben Kay and Alistair Eakin.
Crane marches upfield. Gonovan for Morris. Thompson is out wide. Little Grover kick through. Nicely taken by Thompson, who's in.
And then what a timing of the kick that is from Morris, who's also started brightly. And Thompson has looked a really good finisher since he returned from injury.
Inside the 22, Youngs again. Mulapola into Jonathan Thomas. Crane gets the offload away for Manet! Great finish to the first half. And the Frenchman's on the scoreboard.
A good clear out by Cole. That creates the opportunity. And he knows exactly where Manet is. Holds the delivery until the last possible moment.
And they go to Croft. Alfred Road would like to see the rolling ball Year after year, they've done this, the Tigers, to excellent effect. Jordan Crane is close, very close, over the line in a forest of arms and legs, but the try has been awarded.
And it's that initial surge from the Warriors, but they lose the back of the Tigers' drive. And it's at that stage now, Jordan Crane gets in on the ball. Mulipola adds his weight, and all the green shirts come flying in.
Sua sniping, and Matavesi nearly away. Lost his shorts in the process. This is better from Worcester. They're very close. That's the try line right there, driven on by Abbott.
Use it.
Jerez to Jonathan Thomas. This time it's Leicester manning the barricades.
Seven onside.
Pennell doing the scrum half duties.
Stay back. No hands on the floor, Green.
Lemmy gets it away to Chris Jones, who stretches out.
It's over.
He's through.
Stop, hang on. Wait, you got an injury here.
Could have been an earlier score if he could have just offloaded to Mieres as he came through. But they held their patience, and Tigers weren't particularly good at reorganising when they got close to their line. And the outside line that Chris Jones ran was enough to take him towards the bottom of the posts.
Much better phase play from Worcester. They're beginning to make some headway here, approaching the 22. Mieres, haven't seen him threaten the gain line too much this afternoon. And a switch of direction by Matavesi. That was brilliant from the Fijian. Matavesi is going all the way. Can he get it down?
Time off. Time off. That's my check.
We're heading upstairs to David Grassoff, the television match official.
It's pretty clear there that that's a try.
And there's confirmation. Worcester suddenly have found themselves through Chris Jones and Josh Matavesi. Greater urgency about the Tigers' play now as the clock ticks down. Parling pops it on to Slater, and this is Croft! Racehorse speed from Tom Croft.
Brilliant to cover defence from Hodgson. Probably the best cover defending nine I've seen in the league.
Williams spreads it for Gonova. Cutting back infield, Gonova still going and dummying, and over! What a try from Nicky Gonova! And Gonova was through.
Luke,
what does David Grassoff make of it?
Nothing wrong with the grounding.
You may award the try.
Straight as a die, never in doubt from Owen Williams, and the Tigers' defence of their crown begins in good style, and what style it was finished in today by Nicky Gonova, little piece of magic.
I think we didn't control the breakdown enough as what we did in the first half. We were very good there. Few set pieces. I don't know, we'll have to look at the video, but I'm not sure. Cocker's going to be very happy, so I'm sure. Yeah, I mean, it's good to get the win, bonus point for the crowd. It's been great here at Welford Road. Atmosphere's amazing. So, I mean, we're going to have to look at it and hopefully be better next week.
So that completes the picture of round one of a brand spanking new Aviva Premiership season. And, David, what have we learnt, do you think, of any real significance this weekend?
I think we've learnt that the usual contenders are going to be up there come the business end of the season. Saracens will be up there, Leicester will be up there. But Northampton really laid down the marker for me. How do you react to losing a final so crushingly as they did last season? You recruit well and you take the game to the next level. They look capable of doing that.
And I can't have a man of your shape and size and not ask you about the new scrum laws. Do you think they're going to be a force for good or evil?
They're a force for good. I really believe that. Actually, the opening weekend hasn't been too dramatic. And do you know what? That's good news. I'd love to have more scrums to talk about, but it hasn't been perfect. It never was. It never will be. It will always be a bit of a mess, but we kind of like it imperfect, I think. The ball needs to come out cleanly more often for the game to improve. I think that will happen.
Good omens, I think, for this first weekend. Thanks, Dave, very much. We're back, same time, same place, next week. In fact, every week, same time, same place, for the entire Aviva Premiership season, ITV4, Sunday night, 8 o'clock. Enjoy your week. We'll see you next time. Bye for now.